This Film Is Lit, the podcast where we finally settle the score on one simple question. Is the book really better than the movie? I'm Brian, and I have a film degree, so I watch the movie, but don't read the book.
And I'm Katie. I have an English degree, so I do things the right way and read the book before we watch the movie.
So prepare to be wowed by our expertise and charm as we dissect all of your favorite film adaptations and decide if the silver screen or the written word did it better. So turn it up, settle in, and get ready for spoilers, because this film is lit. Crank up the jazz, pour yourself a gin rickey, and try not to put too much faith in the stock market. We're headed back to the roaring 20s, old sport. It's The Great Gatsby, and this film is lit. Hello and welcome back to This Film Is Lit, the podcast where we talk about movies that are based on books. It's September. That means it's time for the wee little ones to be going back to school, and some of us not so little ones, depending on your career path in life. But it's time for back to school, so we're doing a back to school classic. You voted. It was very close. We landed on The Great Gatsby this time. I'm sure we'll cover those others in the future. But we have every single one of our segments. It's an action-packed, roaring 20 show. So let's get right into it with our summary and Let Me Sum Up.
Let me explain. No, there is too much. Let me sum up.
In the early 1920s, narrator Nick Carraway arrives in New York City to find work selling bonds. He reunites with his cousin Daisy and her husband Tom, and then later meets his enigmatic neighbor, Jay Gatsby. Gatsby is absurdly wealthy and throws wild, lavish parties, but nobody seems to actually know anything about him. As Nick spends more time with Gatsby, it comes to light that Gatsby previously had a romantic relationship with Daisy. Using Nick as a means to reconnect with her, Gatsby rekindles their romantic relationship. However, it proves harder for Daisy to leave her adulterous husband than Gatsby thought it would be. The tension comes to a head one hot night in the city, and Gatsby and Tom confront each other, and it comes to light that Gatsby built his fortune through illegal means. While driving home, Gatsby's car strikes and kills Tom's mistress, Myrtle, allegedly with Daisy at the wheel. Still convinced that Daisy will leave her husband for him, Gatsby says he'll take the blame. However, the next day, Gatsby is shot dead in his swimming pool by Myrtle's husband. Despite his popularity, only three people attend his funeral, Nick being one of them.
All right, and the movie is close enough, so we're going to leave it on that one summary. Let's go ahead now and play the game show portion, which doesn't always make an appearance, but it's back this time with lots of questions in Guess Who?
Who are you?
No one of consequence.
I must know.
Get used to disappointment.
Okay. We do have several Guess Who entries this time, starting with, she was a slender, worldly girl of about 30, with a solid, sticky bob of red hair and a complexion powdered milky white. Her eyebrows had been plucked and then drawn on again at a more rakish angle.
Well, with red hair... the only character that has red hair, or woman that has red hair in the movie, I believe, is Myrtle. She would be worldly. In her 30s, sounds right. That all sounds right for Myrtle. My only other, because Daisy has blonde hair in the movie, and from my memory also does in the book, but I could be wrong about that. Jordan, the golfer, is brunette in the movie. That could be her, I guess. But I'm going to go with that being Myrtle.
You're very close. It's Myrtle's sister, Catherine.
Oh, Catherine. Okay. She does have red hair, yeah. I guess. I don't remember, but I think she does.
Yeah, she has, like, you can kind of see it sticking out from under her cloche hat.
Yes.
Very fashionable there at the time. He was a blonde, spiritless man, anemic, and faintly handsome.
That's so minimal. I assume there wouldn't be such a sparse description for, say, like Gatsby or I guess it could be Gatsby, but it seems unlikely. The spirit list doesn't seem to track at all. I doubt it would be Tom based on that. It could be George. But he's not really, I don't know what he's kind of just dark hair in the movie. I'm trying to think what other characters there are that are important enough. Cause I assume Nick wouldn't be describing himself. I'm going to say George.
It is George.
Oh goodness. Okay. It's the only one I could think of that made any sense, that would have such a short sort of.
It helps that there aren't a ton of characters in this.
There really aren't. Yeah, that's the thing I was trying to cut through. I was like, there's not that many characters, named characters.
He was a sturdy, straw-haired man of 30 with a rather hard mouth. Two shining, arrogant eyes had established dominance over his face. Not even the effeminate swank of his riding clothes could hide the enormous power of that body. He seemed to fill those glistening boots until he strained the top lacing, and you could see a great pack of muscle shifting when his shoulder moved under his thin coat.
Well, our introduction to Tom in the movie is him riding his horse. So the riding clothes would make sense, and the rest of that also makes sense from the Tom we get, who is a very much a jock in the film. So I'm going to say that's Tom. Although he says straw-haired here. He's got, dark hair in the movie, but I'm still going to say that's Tom.
That is Tom. Mm-hmm.
That was pretty easy.
Yeah, the riding clothes really gave it away, but I couldn't find a way around that.
That's fair.
She was in the middle 30s and faintly stout, but she carried her surplus flesh sensuously, as some women can. Her face, above a spotted dress of dark blue, contained no facet or gleam of beauty, but there was an immediately perceptible vitality about her, as if the nerves of her body were continually smoldering.
This, from my memory, I think this is Myrtle. So I'm going to say Myrtle.
Yeah, that is Myrtle.
I don't know why I remembered, but I remembered Myrtle in the book being described as like Kirby. I don't know why I remember that, but standing against all of the rest of the characters who are like incredibly thin, 20s, that stuck out to me that she was described differently.
I kind of love she carried her surplus flesh sensuously, as some women can.
Yep.
It borders on men writing women.
Yeah, it does. It does border on it.
But also, I think I'm going to start saying that about myself. She was a slender, small-breasted girl with an erect carriage, which she accentuated by throwing her body backward at the shoulders like a young cadet. She looked like a good illustration, her chin raised a little, her hair the color of an autumn leaf, her face the same brown tint as the fingerless glove on her knee.
Well, this, I would assume, is either Daisy or Jordan. The hair the color of an autumn leaf would insinuate a reddish, brownish color, which Jordan's hair is. And I could have swore that in the book, Daisy had blonde hair, but if that's the case, we don't have a Daisy description, which makes me think this has to be Daisy. I'm going to say this is Daisy.
That's actually Jordan.
Frick, I should have went with Jordan. I thought that the fit for Jordan, but
there's actually not really a description of Daisy in the book. There are parts of her that are occasionally given adjectives.
Yeah.
But she doesn't have a description like a lot of the other characters do.
Okay. Well, I'm going to count that as a correct, because I would have gotten that right. If I got that by itself and I wasn't reading ahead to see that there was no description of Daisy or no more female descriptions left, I would have guessed Jordan. But
okay, we'll count that one.
My metagame ruined me there.
All right. Last one. His tanned skin was drawn attractively tight on his face, and his short hair looked as though it were trimmed every day.
I mean, the only character we really have left, because we already got George, it would be Gatsby. I think, because I don't know if we ever meet him in the book, but he's a character, the the bootlegger that Gatsby is in cahoots with, whose name I can't recall
because it's long. Wolfsheim.
So I'm gonna say that that's Gatsby.
That is Gatsby.
Just because he's got to get his hair, he's rich enough he can get his hair cut every day.
This as close as we really get to a description of Gatsby. It's pretty sparse.
Yeah.
We don't really learn that much about him from this description. Nick does spend like a very long paragraph talking about how great his smile is.
Ah.
But this is as much of a physical description as we get.
Fair enough. All right. So I didn't do too bad. I missed two of them technically, but I would have got. I was close. So, whatever. I did okay. Could have done worse.
Well, I think you would have gotten Catherine if I had put Myrtle's description ahead of hers.
I think so. I actually think I would have gotten... No, actually, I wouldn't have, because I wouldn't have remembered Catherine. She's not important enough of a character. She's in a half a minute of the movie. Like, I would not have... I probably would have gone with Jordan, honestly, at that point. But anyways, so I don't think I would have got it. But all that being said, I only miss two. So, not that bad. All right, I've got a lot more questions. Let's get into them. Was that in the book?
Nicholas Flamel is the only known maker of the Philosopher's Stone.
The what?
Honestly, don't you two read?
So in the film, we're introduced to our narrator of the story, played by Tobey Maguire, one Nick Carraway. And from my memory of having read this book, like I said, back in high school or whatever, I did recall Nick being the narrator from my memory, I thought, but I didn't remember him being in like a sanatorium, which is where he is at the start of the film. Is that what from the one is Nick the narrator and two is he in a sanatorium?
So Nick is the narrator. You remembered that, right? There's no indication that I picked up on that he's writing everything down from a sanatorium. And I have mixed feelings about that change. I understand the need for a frame story because I don't think that this would work without Nick's narration.
Mm-hmm.
So we need an excuse to have him narrating the story. But having him be like talking to a doctor and then literally writing the book feels cliche and outdated.
Is he not writing it down or writing? Is that there's no implication of that at all? Like the writing it?
I don't think so.
In the book? Okay. I couldn't remember, so I didn't know.
If there is, I did not catch it at all. I don't think there is in the book.
It's just more of a, like, it's just narrated.
Yeah, it's just narrated by him. Like, he is, like, remembering it.
Right.
But
there's no indication.
Yeah, there's no indication that he's, like, writing this as a novel.
Okay. So I'm thinking this is correct based on the character description, but I did not remember this from my reading. And when we're introduced to Tom Buchanan in the movie, he's, like, hopping off a horse, and he gets inside, and we're walking through his trophy room and all this sort of stuff, and he's like this big jock, and he's like like a stereotypical jock, and I did not recall that being part of his character in the book, but I have forgot almost everything about this book, and I wanted to know if that version of him in the movie is the characterization from the book.
He is. I think the movie does emphasize that a little bit more than the book does, but yeah, he's like your typical rich kid who was an athlete at his rich kid prep school.
Okay. Which makes sense because it's the juxtaposition of his old money.
Yes.
With
Gatsby's new money.
Also, Tom, when in this introduction, turns out Tom's a giant racist, or not his introduction, but they're having dinner. I think it's Tom, Daisy, Nick, and Jordan.
Yeah. Yes.
All having dinner. And just Tom starts going on this diatribe about race science and race mixing, and they're all like moderately annoyed by this, and I did not recall that at all, but I could be wrong. Is Tom a giant racist? Even for his time, is Tom a giant of the 1920s? Is he a giant racist?
Yeah, he is. That scene is almost verbatim. Like, he just brings it up.
Yeah.
And starts going on about how, like, white people are the master race. Mm. And everybody is like, okay, sweetie.
Great.
All right.
Great.
Sit down before you hurt yourself.
You're racist
even for us. Yeah, right.
A bunch of white people in the 1920s.
Rich white people in the 1920s.
Yeah. I did not remember that. That's interesting. I will say, because on Wikipedia or whatever, when I was doing research for the movie, like in one of the sections for the book, it talks about themes, and or one of the themes mentioned somewhere was race. And maybe we can talk about that more. But like, obviously, it's brought up here and it's brought up again later by Tom.
Mm-hmm.
Again, just sort of offhandedly saying racist stuff. But it definitely, to me at least, didn't feel like the movie ever, the story ever follows through with it in any way that felt like commentary, other than like the guy who's kind of the bad guy, kind of, is racist and that's bad. But like, apart from that, it doesn't feel, at least to me, I didn't feel like it went anywhere.
It's definitely like comes up similarly in the book. I don't think I would personally call it one of the like main themes of the book, but okay. It definitely is something that comes up.
Okay. There's a line when Daisy is talking to, I think, Nick in this moment. I can't remember who, about having a child.
Yeah, she's talking to Nick.
About if they have a child or something like that.
He asks about her little girl.
Yes, because they do have a child. We just never see that child in the
movie. We don't see her in the movie till like the very end.
She doesn't exist. I forgot because I saw the kid at the end. And I was like, wait, was there a time jump where they had a kid?
No, they had a kid
that we just never. It's just meant.
And
that's
we
right.
do like we see her a couple times in the book, but not in the movie.
She talked about once she at the beginning and then shows up at the very end, and I was confused by that. But I do remember now that that's what they were talking about. And Daisy has this line. That's the best thing a girl in this world can be, a beautiful little fool. And I thought I remembered that line from the book, and I wanted to know if it was from the book, because it's a good line.
Yeah, that is directly from the book. One of the lines from the book that is, like, oft dissected.
Yes.
And it's also supposedly what Zelda Fitzgerald said after their daughter was born. So we can count that as something else that F. Scott cribbed from her.
Oh, fair enough. I mean, yeah, there's definitely a lot of
there's a lot to unpack
commentary within
right there.
That line about patriarchy and then women's place in society and the ways that women, especially in the time period, the easiest ways to succeed and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, was to be beautiful
to
and
be beautiful and
not,
to not
care that everything sucked.
Yeah, and to, because I think there's even an implication, like a beautiful fool, like, yeah, not care that things sucked, but also even if you do care, like, or notice to, like, because I think you could even read, like, especially in Daisy's case, she's aware, but she doesn't speak up about it. Like, she sort of holds her tongue in that regard. And I think that you could also read it that way in terms of, like, even if you do recognize pretending to be a fool, I guess, like, you know, pretending to not to notice or sort of not bringing up the obvious inequality and that sort of thing, and then obviously a lot more of that, but as I said, I remember that light or that line. Speaking of light, and the reason I said light, and I remember this from the book, the green light across the bay, what's the green light? That's the American dream, right? From
yeah. Okay. The green light, I think, is one of the most recognizable elements from this book. I feel like that's something
that
random that people just tend to remember. But I think people wouldn't remember the eyes so much if they weren't
wasn't
on the cover of the book.
Yeah.
These aren't the exact
eyes. To be fair,
eyes,
though, I do remember. We discussed the sort of symbolism of the eyes at length.
Yeah.
In high school or whatever. I don't remember. I mean, I remember discussing the light, the green light, a little bit, but not to the same.
I think those are definitely the two things that, like, get focused on the most in your high school English class.
Because they are one of those things that's very obvious symbolism that it's, like, very apparent. And it's not easy to miss because they recur so often. Mm-hmm. And it's, like,
Scott Fitzgerald is here have some symbolism.
Yes, it's not subtle symbolism.
No.
And we'll talk about whether or not the movie even makes it more overt, specifically in reference to the eyes later. I have a question about that at some point, I'm pretty sure. But the green light, so sorry, continue about, yeah.
So yeah, it does tend to get broadly associated with the American dream because Gatsby's goal of being with Daisy is basically like that represents the American dream. I.e. the dream of becoming wealthy and successful enough to rise up out of your social class, right? In this case, by marrying someone into your in that social class. So since the green light is literally like a light linking Gatsby to Daisy, it then gets seen as a representation of like, oh, the American dream.
Yeah.
The green light.
Yes. I mean, also there's some obvious implications of it being green. I'm sure there are some technical reasons, maybe at the time of like the, what kind of chemical was burning to create said light or whatever. But there's the very, which I assume this saying, like the grass is greener on the other side.
Yeah.
I
green like money.
Green like money, green of envy, green with envy, all of those things. Green generally gets applied to greed, envy.
Yes.
All those sorts of things. And so that inherently.
Yeah, and I'm not sure. I don't know if in the book they ever discuss what the light actually is. It's like a little lighthouse beacon thing.
In the movie, it's like a buoy.
Yeah.
It's like a buoy floating near the dock.
And green is not a light color that I associate with any of those things, but I don't know.
No, but like I said, usually I assume with weird color lights that it's because they were burning, like I said, some random chemical, like it was like a phosphorus or
something,
whatever.
Something that's not used anymore.
Yeah, it's not used because it's, you know, that was just what they had at the time or whatever. But so we get a scene where Nick goes to hang out with Tom at Myrtle's. No, yes.
It's like an apartment that they keep where they can go and have their illicit affair.
Yes, their affair apartment. And he he encounters Catherine and then some other people who are friends.
Yeah, there's another couple, the McKees.
And they all have a raucous partying time, and Nick talks about how it's only his second time drinking. And it's like the debauchery and the corruption of Nick Carraway. And I didn't recall that scene at all from the book in my memory, and I wanted to know if that is from the book. Because it's interesting.
So that scene where they all party is in the book. He does say that it's only his second time drinking. And the idea of him being like kind of corrupted from this like wholesome Midwestern boy into like a city dweller.
A city boy.
Not not an element in the book, but I do think that's something that the movie plays up and emphasizes, especially that party scene in particular.
Yeah.
I didn't read it as quite so like raucous and debaucherous in the book.
Interesting.
Not quite so.
Yeah. So there's a we get to the big reveal of Gatsby. Like Leonardo DiCaprio doesn't show up in this movie until like 30 minutes in, which makes sense. But he gets this big reveal where he's talking to Nick, and Nick doesn't realize who he's talking to, and we're kind of, it's like an over the shoulder shot, so we only see like the side of Gatsby's face a little bit. And Nick's talking to him, and then we get this big swing camera swing around reveal, and he says, "You see, I'm Gatsby." And then we fireworks go off, and it's all this big dramatic moment. It's a lot of fun. It's the gif, the meme gif from the movie comes from this moment where he
toasts the glass.
Comes from this moment, and I want to know if there's such a dramatic reveal moment for Gatsby in the book. Because I hope so.
it's similar. I see where the movie got it, but it's not as dramatic as what's in the movie. So what happens in the book is Nick is sitting at a table at a Gatsby party, talking to some people, and he mentions that he's been looking for the host all night, but he hasn't been able to find him, to which the man he's talking to responds, "Oh, I am Gatsby."
Okay.
So there, like, there's no fireworks or anything.
Yeah.
But it is like a similar idea. And I liked that change in the movie. It's a little silly for sure, especially now that we've been memeing it for 6 years.
I had no idea that was where the meme.
I didn't realize that was the moment.
I thought it could have been any moment.
Yeah, it could have been any moment from one of his parties. But I thought that the movie's version hit a good note of like heightened reality. and really further impresses on the audience that Gatsby is this larger than life, almost mythic figure.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think it works really well. Again, yeah. Apart from setting it apart from the meme that it's become, if you divorce it from that, I think it works fine.
Mm-hmm.
And it is the conversation is like identical, where he's like talking about how he hasn't met the setup
yes.
for it is basically
yeah the
identical.
Setup is basically the same, it,
which Baz Luhrmann is wont to do.
Yes.
So
and also as a side note, when I read that scene in the book this time, all I could hear in my head was Christian Bale Batman.
I'm Gatsby. Yeah, that's a fun SNL skit, like digital short. It's a trailer of Gatsby or a trailer for Batman, but played by Gatsby. One of the two. You could go either way with it. You could either make it a Batman movie trailer with Gatsby, or you could make it a Gatsby trailer with a Batman type of, but Gatsby's like Batman. Either way, I think it would be fun. Yeah, absolutely. Because you could go through Nolan's films and pull like all the choice quotes and rework them to fit with Gatsby. And then just have him doing the Batman voice the whole time for no reason. I like that. All right. I like that a lot. So let's go ahead and talk about the old sport. Does Gatsby really say old sport that much? Because I don't remember in the book him saying it like every sentence. Because in this movie, he says it like every sentence.
It's not quite that much in the book. Not quite so much. I really didn't care for the way that Leonardo DiCaprio pronounced old sport.
Really?
I felt like he was trying to do an accent, but I couldn't figure out.
To me, he's just trying to do a little bit of the transatlantic, like the that era's TV, like movie star accent. Like,
but then I thought, like, maybe that's the point. Like, he's faking an accent to sound like he's from somewhere, but he's not actually from it, and he's bad at it.
I think that actually kind of works in that regard. Yeah, because I think it, and it kind of does fall in line with the transatlantic accent, which wasn't a real accent. It was it was like a weird mishmash of, like,
made-up radio
and,
accent.
Yeah, like, made-up radio, or radio and movie accent, kind of combining British and other elements of other stuff, Yeah, I think it works. I think it's fun.
I guess it just bugged me because I felt like it mostly showed up when he said old sport.
Yeah.
Which was like every sentence.
That is true. And he does say it literally like every sentence. So at one point, he takes Nick into his fancy car and goes speeding down the road in his fancy car. And he gets pulled over, not even pulled over. A cop pulls up on a motorcycle while they're flying down the road. And Gatsby shows him his ID. Aren't they still driving?
Yeah, they're still driving. It's like a business card.
That
just says his name on it.
Yeah, he shows him his business card to the police officer and then just doesn't get pulled over because of it. And I was like, I do not recall this from the book.
That actually is from the book. That happens. That's exactly what happens in the book. The only real difference is that in the book, it specifically says that he slows down a little before showing him the
card. I think he does slow down a little in the movie, but they're still moving pretty good.
Yeah.
Because they were flying. But yeah, I did not remember that at all.
I think the scenes where they're driving, though, might have been my favorite parts of this movie.
It is interesting. They do an interesting, they chose a very distinct look and feel for the driving scenes that definitely heightens the sort of chaotic nature of the driving. And also it's all CG as well, but it kind of works in those scenes. Like it
looks like hyper real.
It's this weird hyper realistic look that works because it is almost like this. Because there's a big thing in the book from my memory of that drive from through the ash through whatever it's called.
Valley of the Ashes.
And they drive through there a lot, and it's definitely this. It's sort of this symbolic journey from the old money to the new money and all that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's like a no man's land
through the no man's land in between and that sort of thing. And And so kind of heightening it into this weird hyper-realistic, like, I don't even know how to describe it. It is really interesting, and I think it does work. It was one of my, I agree, it was also one of my sort of favorite things they did in the movie. And I was trying to think if it reminded me of anything else. Like, it reminds me of anything, if of anything, it reminds me of watching, like, pod racing in, like, the Star Wars movie, like, like episode one or something like that. I don't know. It was, yeah, it was interesting. I did not know, though, that just still driving, showing him his card, like, I'm Gatsby, get out of here. afterwards, they go to lunch and they go to this sweet underground jazz club that is, because this is in Prohibition, obviously. Mm-hmm. And they go to this like underground speakeasy kind of place, and it's this cool club. And they meet, I think Tom's there.
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody's there basically, except for, I don't think Daisy's there.
I think it's like a men's club.
It's like a men's club, yeah.
There are some showgirls there.
Right. And anyways, I thought that was interesting. And it's also, there's a lot of, black people in this club because it is like an underground jazz club. And I assume that I want to know if any of this element of this club, cause it wasn't a scene that I recalled. Not a lot happens here. I'm trying to remember what even does happen here.
Oh, that's where they have the conversation with Wolfsheim.
Yes.
Where they meet him.
Yes. Is any of that from the book?
Gatsby does take Nick to lunch. The book says that the club is in a 42nd Street cellar, so it could have been like an underground type of club, but it's not specifically mentioned. They don't like go through a barber shop and have like they have to like knock on the wall and like give a password or whatever in the movie. So there's none of that. But I did think that was interesting. I liked that change. I thought it made sense to make it basically like a speakeasy.
Yeah.
I think that's something that people coming to see a movie set in the 1920s will be expecting to see. So it makes sense to just put it in there.
It also makes sense, attaching it to Wolfsheim's character, who is that he is a bootlegger and that sort of thing. So having him be hanging out in a bootlegging establishment seems reasonable. So they set up this mystery. We get the backstory of how Gatsby and Daisy were in a relationship at one point, and they broke up, and she ends up getting married to Tom. And we get this set up in this moment kind of early in the, you know, around the end of Act One or something, where we're going to we're getting information from the letter that Gatsby wrote Daisy, but and he says something to her, but we don't find out what it was that he said in the letter. And then that kind of trails off and we find out later. But I want to know if that like mystery of the letter and like what was said and what happened is from the book, or if that's like a movie drama added.
Yes. So we do find out that Daisy received a letter from Gatsby on the eve of her wedding, drank herself into a stupor, yelling that she'd changed her mind.
Yeah.
And then goes ahead and gets married to Tom. I don't think we ever find out what was actually in the letter, though. I tried to go back and flip through and look, and I couldn't find like that specific scene from the movie.
Yeah.
And I could be misremembering that. But I think that the movie may have kind of borrowed that from Fitzgerald's own life.
Yeah.
Because we know that he did, like, ask Zelda to, like, he was like, oh, I don't have any money, but will you wait for me?
Yeah.
Which is basically what we find out was in the letter that Gatsby wrote.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting. So then Gatsby wants Nick to invite Daisy over to have tea. And they're going to have tea at Nick's house in his he lives in like a very small little, like, it's like the servant's
like a little
house
cottage
or something like that in between, right next to Gatsby's. And, he's inviting Daisy over. And when we get there in the movie, the house is just packed with flowers. Like, there's so many flowers everywhere. And we get this very comical reveal of them like standing in the middle. And there's just flowers everywhere. And Gatsby marches all of his servants over with like food and stuff in the rain. And I wanted to know if that weird sort of, because he's obviously trying to put on this grand show for Daisy.
Yes.
And it turns into this weird absurdity in the framing of Nick's house. And I wanted to know if that's from the book.
I think we can assume that that's what the house would look like. The text says a greenhouse arrived from Gatsby's.
Okay.
There wasn't any indication that he brought a bunch of food. But he also does have them mow the lawn in the rain. So that's also from the book.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, the greenhouse arrangement, that implies, flowers and stuff all over the place. Okay. Speaking of, so once Daisy shows up, Gatsby becomes just a giant clumsy oaf and is like knocking things over and stuff. And it's a very movie joke moment. Like, it plays like something right out of a film.
Mm-hmm.
In this moment when Daisy shows up and he breaks the clock on the mantle. And I want to know if that came from the book, because I didn't remember that.
Yes, it does. Right down to him knocking the clock off the mantle. It's all from the book.
Yeah. This, I did enjoy that whole little lunch scene. I thought it was very funny, like, well handled comically. And the absurdity of, like, all the flowers and everything, and Gatsby running out and then coming. Does he do that? Does he leave and come back? Yeah,
he
does.
He leaves and comes back.
Okay, because I didn't remember that, and I thought that was really... He shows up at the front door, and he's, like, covered in rain because he ran out, but then he ended up coming back. The whole scene is fun, and apparently from the book. Then we kind of get a montage of them rekindling their relationship, and at one point she comes over to Gatsby's house, and we get this big scene of him walking around talking about all the clothes he has, and he's like throwing, she's like sitting on his bed, and he's like throwing, literally showering his wealth onto Daisy, literally actually ultimately kind of suffocating and crushing her with it, which obviously is not subtle, but I wanted to know if that moment of, you know, that sort of triumphant pouring of wealth onto Daisy now that Gatsby has, you know, made it, came from the book.
That's not quite as literal in the book. He's not showering his shirts down onto her.
Yeah.
But he does show her around the house after they have tea, and he shows off like all of his rooms and possessions, including his huge collection of fine shirts.
Okay.
And she does start crying over it all. She's like overwhelmed.
Yeah.
And I actually really liked that change. I thought it was another thing that was appropriately heightened from what the book gives us.
Yeah, and I think the kind of on the nose symbolism fits in well with what we get in Gatsby, which is a lot of
kind of on the nose symbolism,
which is why it's taught, you know, in middle school and high school. Which is funny because it's the symbolism's on the nose, but thematically, I think the messaging of Gatsby's way more nuanced. Like it's a little bit more like nuanced and sort of hard to like grasp at that age. The symbolism is like very, again, it's like it's a green light. It represents the American dream and how it's unattainable. It's always across the bay, blah, blah, blah. That also represents day. Like, oh, the eyes of God, blah, blah, blah. Like it's cut like easy to talk about what the symbolism is, but I feel like it's much harder to discuss like what it actually means compared to some other things that we've talked about. I don't know. I thought that was really interesting upon rewatch this time of like, there's a lot going on thematically and it is easy to kind of point it out, but I don't know how easy it is to discuss it, how easy it would be to discuss it in a high school setting because there's so much like context I feel like you need.
Well, and here we arrive at something that I don't think we've ever talked about on this show, which at this point is rare. And this is not a unique opinion. I acknowledge that. I believe very firmly that literature should be taught concurrently with history.
Yeah.
That is a big teacher platform of mine. If you're reading a book from the 1920s in your literature class, you should be learning about the 1920s in your history class.
Right. And I think that does happen sometimes.
It happens sometimes. Sometimes it lines up. I always noticed when it lined up in school. But it's not, I mean, unless you're in with the history teacher, it's not built into the curriculum.
Yeah.
And I think it should be.
Yeah. The other thing I remember is that usually your English teacher or whatever would try to give like a quick sort of.
Right. But it needs to be more than that. And it needs to be something, in my opinion, that is not the responsibility of just one teacher.
Yeah.
Because it's too much to cover. And there is like there's so much context here that if you're missing that context, you're really missing the themes and the message, like you said.
Yeah. Yeah, it, absolutely. And it is, obviously, the movie tries to then up, I think, by nature of some of the changes the movie makes in regards to using modern music, which I'm still not sure how much of a fan I was of, which we'll talk about maybe more later. But, like, using modern music and turning it and like, some of the heightened, heightening of all this stuff, sort of, it was an clearly the intent was to update it and make it more applicable to a modern audience. Mm. And I think a lot of the themes still work. It is interesting because the thing that's interesting about this movie is that comparing it to something like Baz Luhrmann's Romeo and Juliet, where he takes all of the dialogue and everything and keeps it exactly the same,
yes,
but just makes the setting a modern one.
Yes.
Whereas this movie...
And, like,
movie,
a very stylized
modern one. A stylized modern one, but essentially a modern setting. Whereas this movie keeps it in the period and keeps the dialogue. This doesn't really update anything other than a little bit of, like, the like, gilding around the edges. Again, like, mm-hmm. the soundtrack and stuff. I thought was... I don't know. I actually think it would have been... I would have been more interested to see this movie done, if Baz Luhrmann had done what he did to Romeo and Juliet with it, I think maybe would have been more interesting. Like
something
truly
really,
updated
really,
it.
Really
like
stylized.
Just do, because I think you could just do the Great Gatsby set in 2008 or whatever, or like set in like the market recession or like before, you know, like post 9/11. But like in that time period, I feel like there's a very similar parallels you could pull and do a very similar thing. And do, I mean, do the story, but do it in, I don't know. I just, it's interesting. Anyways, we got a lot more to talk about. So, we get these recurring mysterious phone calls in the movie where Gatsby always gets a call and he goes off into the background to kind of like talk to somebody that we never see. Eventually we figure out it's Wolfsheim and it's his shady business dealings. But do we get that in the book, that recurring, like, what's Gatsby up to? Because the movie, I feel like, plays it a little more, like...
It's a little sinister.
I kind of knew. I was like, well, I'm pretty sure it's just, like, his business dealings or whatever. But, mm-hmm. like, the movie kind of plays it sinister, and it never goes anywhere. And I want to know if the movie or the book set up that similar kind of, like, ooh, mystery.
So the phone calls, that happens once or twice throughout the book, but it is definitely something that the movie takes and runs with.
Okay. So then we have this big dramatic lunch where Gatsby's like, all right, him and Daisy have been having an affair of some caliber for a while now. And he wants her to reveal to Tom. This is his big triumph, you know, reveal. Mm-hmm. She has to tell Tom that she doesn't love him and that she wants to be with Gatsby. And this is Gatsby needs this for himself.
Yes, Gatsby's ego needs this.
He desperately needs this to happen. And it's this big affair and a big to do. But Daisy can't do it at first, but then she does. But it's all at the pressuring of Gatsby and it's all very uncomfortable. And Nick is just sitting there like he is way too good of a sport. Maybe that's why Gatsby calls him old sport all the time, because he is way too good at just sitting there for the really awkward, horrifying conversations and just like kind of taking it in. Him and Jordan both.
No, I have a note later down in my like general notes that was an alternate title for this book could be My Extremely Messy Rich Friends and How I Was Their Third Wheel All Summer.
Yeah. For real.
Because that's basically Nick's summer.
Yep. It really is. It's anyways, that big the big messy lunch scene, is that from the book?
Yes. That scene is like nearly verbatim from the book.
Okay. Cause I didn't recall, and I did really like the way what it belies in Gatsby's character, mm-hmm. the way he keeps pressuring her and how she has to say it and how he need like reiterating and reinforcing the very clear sort of picture we've gotten of Gatsby at this point, which who starts out as sort of this like triumphant, victorious, idealized American dream character. But then the sort of layers get peeled away and it's revealed that it's all one that's kind of built on a lie in the sense of like he's it's not really. That could be discussed. It's built on as much of a lie as any other millionaire, you know, super wealthy person. And I think that's also kind of the point. But it is all kind of built on a lie. But also on top of that, that none of that was the actual goal. Like none of the wealth, none of the actual stuff that he has was meant anything to him. It was
it's a means to an end.
Means to an end. And that end isn't even Daisy because he has her here.
Yes.
It's not even having Daisy. It's having the victory over Tom and over the people who told him.
The victory over that old money elite.
Yeah.
Who kept him from having what he wanted in the first place, essentially.
Yeah, and that, and to the point where, it's, you know, to an outsider's view, it's like, or, you know, and to Nick at first, I think, like, he thinks this is all for Daisy, but Gatsby literally blows up everything he has because he has to, including Daisy at this point, because he has to have that moment of victory.
It's not enough for him that he is absurdly wealthy, and it's not enough for him that he does have Daisy
who started this moment. Whole thing.
He needs that exterior, that external
validation. Yeah. His ego requires it. Yeah. Because, I mean, that ultimately is what kind of boils down to the whole thing, you know, and Gatsby's tragic flaw and the tragedy of Gatsby is his ego.
Yeah.
And his vanity, not even vanity necessarily, but ego, and desperate need and desire to be seen as embodying, you know, the American dream. Not that he doesn't even need to achieve the American dream because he has it in this moment. He has the money. He has Daisy, like you said. But it's not even that he has to be seen as having the American dream. He has to, or not even that he has to have the American dream. It's that he has to be seen as having conquered the American dream. Yeah.
He has to win.
He has
Gatsby
to win.
Gatsby does.
Yeah. And that's not a unique character flaw in many of the greatest villains and heroes in literary and film history has been, you know, their flaw. But it is, I think, particularly well done in this story. And that scene in the movie, I thought, was really well handled. Gatsby's pink suit, because Tom has a real fascination with the pink suit. He keeps mentioning that Gatsby's in his pink suit.
Mm-hmm.
And he's, anyways,
yes.
I
want
to know if that comes from
the
book.
Yes, it is. In the book, Tom does mention Gatsby's pink suit several times, and I had to look this one up. According to the internet, at the time, pink had major class connotations. It's not a color that men who came from money would have worn, so it outs Gatsby as being one of the gauche nouveau riche.
Okay.
Which is kind of interesting because now pink menswear is something that I kind of associate with, like, the preppy country club types.
Yeah.
Like your pink polo and your boat shoes on your yacht.
Right.
But I think this is a good example of what we were talking about earlier, where you really need that historical context, because I think a lot of modern readers are going to interpret this as Tom attacking Gatsby's masculinity. But that association didn't exist yet.
But I think the movie does imply that, because I swear, and I don't remember, I don't have it written down, but I swear they're associated with one of the times when he comments on the pink suit. He has a line about it being, I don't know the word he uses, but I swear he, in the movie, he uses a word to describe Gatsby in his pink suit like flamboyant or something like that. He says it in a way, a word that, especially to modern audiences, which if it's not from the book, the movie very specifically added, that would imply to modern audiences that that it is like a masculinity thing, that he's implying that he's gay or something like that, or again attacking his masculinity. And I thought the movie had a line that also tied it to that. But I could be wrong about that.
I would have to know exactly what the line was to be able to look it up.
I didn't write down specifically.
But it also wouldn't surprise me that the movie would understand that the implication that the book is giving us would be lost on a modern audience, and would just kind of lean into that.
Yeah, adapting it into the attack on his masculinity.
Yeah.
Which I think also leads into some more stuff we're going to talk about eventually, and some of the lenses you can view this movie and read this story through, which I thought is something that this movie in particular leaned into at times.
Yes.
But we'll talk about that a little bit later. Gatsby and Tom have this big dramatic confrontation. I don't remember when this happens exactly. Is this when he goes to punch him, I think?
Yeah, that's right before this.
No, that's later. That's later. So I don't know what this confrontation is, but Gatsby yells at him, "Your wife doesn't love you, she loves me." And it's this big dramatic confrontation, and I didn't remember that scene.
It's kind of similar. A lot of the lines are the same. I think the movie captures the mood of that whole, kind of portion of the film pretty well.
Yeah. Though, actually, this might just be during the lunch still.
I can't remember if that happens during the lunch.
I think it is, because I don't think they've left anything yet. I think all my notes are still during that.
And I also definitely have the wrong page number in there, because that happens way later in the book. They're at the hotel when this scene happens.
In the book. I don't remember them being at the hotel.
I don't remember, because they start out, they're having lunch at Tom and Daisy's.
Yeah.
And then Daisy, freaks out, and she's like, "Let's go downtown."
Yeah.
"Let's go downtown." So they go downtown, and they end up, at a hotel.
Yeah.
Just hanging out.
Yeah. And then they come back to the house at one point. But, yeah. So this might be happening at the second time back at the house. I don't remember.
No, because when they leave the hotel, that's when the car accident happens.
I thought they were... okay. I guess that's possible. In my head, they went somewhere, and then they came back, because I thought they were in the same room when she storms out and then the car accident happens. I thought they were in the same room that they were in from the lunch from earlier.
I think it's just a similar looking room.
I don't know. It doesn't really matter the exact location, but yeah.
"Your wife doesn't love you," said Gatsby quietly. "She's never loved you. She loves me." "You must be crazy," exclaimed Tom automatically. Gatsby sprang to his feet, livid with excitement. "She never loved you, do you hear?" she cried. He cried, "She only married you because I was poor and she was tired of waiting for me. It was a terrible mistake, but in her heart, she never loved anyone except me."
Mm.
At that point, Jordan and I tried to go.
Welp! Looks like it's about that time.
Something from this scene that the movie cut is another racist moment for Tom.
I don't think they do. I think they leave this in. I remember
Are you
this.
Sure?
I remembered this in the movie. Reading your description here, I remember this line in the movie.
I didn't catch it then.
I'm pretty sure it is.
Yeah, he says, "I suppose the latest thing is to sit back and let Mr. Nobody from Nowhere make love to your wife. Well, if that's the idea, you can count me out. Nowadays, people begin by sneering at family life and family institutions, and next they'll throw everything overboard and have intermarriage between black and white."
That exact line is in the movie, 100%. Because I remember the whole sneering at family and family values.
People are still freaking saying that.
Yeah, yeah. Tom is the embodiment of every right-wing, moneyed, conservative, person, and... The lines have not the talking points have not changed.
No, it's a great example of how this type of person will slippery slope their arguments out of nowhere.
Yeah.
If we let the classes intermingle, next thing you know, they'll be letting the races intermingle too. My guy, we were not even talking about that.
Yep. But go off, I guess. Thanks for outing yourself. Although they all knew already, but yeah. And then speaking of that, because Gatsby goes off and on yelling about how she's never loved anybody except for Gatsby. And then she's like, "No, actually I did love Tom at one point." And this screws everything up for Gatsby and is really what pushes him over the edge. Does she say that in the book? Does that come from the book, that her telling Gatsby, "No, actually I did love Tom at one point"?
Yeah, that scene is, again, almost verbatim.
Yeah.
And I do think it's kind of, like, yeah, that is like a point where we see things start to really, really turn.
Yeah.
Because Gatsby has idealized Daisy.
Yes, absolutely.
To an incredible point, to that when she responds to this very tense, difficult situation that he's put her in.
Yeah.
In an incredibly human and understandable way. Because yeah. I would lose my mind in that situation, too. I'd be like, stop talking to me.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk to you. But he can't handle it.
Yeah.
She reacts like a human being.
Yeah.
But that's not what he has in his mind.
No. Absolutely. And then Tom reveals that Gatsby's a bootlegger and a bond trader and all of these things that, you know, he sees
very
as sort
unsavory.
Of unsavory ways to have acquired his wealth, whereas he did it the right way while being born to rich parents. Does Tom reveal that all to everybody in the book?
Definitely the bootlegging. Bond trader specifically is something that the movie added, but the book does say that Tom found out that there's something even bigger going on that people are afraid to talk to him about. Mm. So I think it makes sense to just put in bond trader there because we've already talked about it.
Yeah, I mean, because that's what Nick does.
Yeah.
Basically. And then Gatsby, during this big confrontation, he grabs Tom and is about to punch him or kiss him, and I couldn't tell which. We'll talk more about that later. Does that physical confrontation happen in the book?
That does not happen in the book. And I gotta be honest, I didn't particularly care for it as an addition to that scene. To me, it felt a little, like, on the nose and, like, too much.
Yeah. I only liked it in the way it was portrayed because it felt... The reason I wrote the note, he's about to punch him or kiss him, wasn't just, like, a joke. Like, there's an interesting energy in that moment in the movie that felt very intentional to me based on some of the other stuff, and we'll talk about it. But I don't disagree that it doesn't necessarily it feels a little on the nose, but and then they storm out. Daisy storms out. Gatsby chases after, and leads to the accident. And then it comes to Tom or Nick, and Nick says, I just remembered, today's my birthday. And then Tom just looks at him like, what the fuck is wrong with you? And I loved that moment in the movie, and I wanted to know if that was from the book, because that's great comedic timing by Nick. And Tom, for that matter, if it is from the book.
So Nick does randomly say that it's his birthday at the end of that scene.
Okay.
But we don't get a reaction from Tom. But I did like that in the movie. In the book, we just get Nick then some ennui about, like, turning 30.
Right. I'm turning 30. Yeah. My stupid friends
are having stupid children. A decade of loneliness.
Yeah.
They said that in the movie, and I was like, thanks.
Yep, right. This I got to talk about. So we're setting up to the accident where Myrtle gets hit by the car, and at this point of George and Myrtle are having a fight. We cut to them having a fight because he now is aware that she's been cheating on him or whatever. And he's yelling at Myrtle, and he yells at her, you might fool me, but you don't fool God. God sees everything. And we get like a cut of the freaking, the doctor, the optometrist billboard. And I was like, okay. Cause I wanted to know if that was from the book specifically, because it's like, The symbolism is not subtle already, and then for the movie to be like, God sees everything, show billboard of those giant eyes watching over the Valley of Ashes or whatever, and I was like, okay, is that line from the book? Is the book that unsubtle?
So we don't see this happen like we do in the movie, but we find out later that, yes, this is something that George said to Myrtle.
Okay.
I can find it real quick because there is something about the eyes.
Oh, is there?
In that moment. I just have to find it. I spoke to her, he muttered after a long silence. I told her she might fool me, but she couldn't fool God. I took her to the window. With an effort, he got up and walked to the rear window and leaned with his face pressed against it. And I said, God knows what you've been doing, everything you've been doing. You may fool me, but you can't fool God. Behind him, McAllis saw with a shock that he was looking at the eyes of Dr. T.J. Eckelberg, which had just emerged pale and enormous from the dissolving night. "God sees everything," repeated Wilson. "That's an advertisement," McAllis assured him.
That's good. That's a funny line. That's funny.
So, like...
So, no, exactly. I mean, that's exactly the moment from the movie that we see.
And it is as unsubtle. It is as unsubtle, but then Fitzgerald, like, acknowledges how unsubtle it is.
Like, he does at least make a joke about it. I will say that, and I don't know if we have a point at anywhere where you were going to talk about the whole the eyes thing, but that's some symbolism that just doesn't work for me, and I don't get what it's trying to say. Do you have any, you know what I mean? Like, I get, I don't know. I guess part of it would be like, I don't know enough about F. Scott Fitzgerald's like sort of philosophical, theological views, if that has anything to do with it or like what those eyes in the context of this story and the idea that's sort of the, you know, an omniscient being like God watching all things or whatever, like what that actually means in context here. Because it's not something I've ever really thought of. We talked about it in high school, and I was like, this is boring. I don't care.
This is just me talking, like, off the cuff. Uh-huh. I didn't bone up on the eyes of Dr. T.J. Eckelberg before this episode. Because I didn't have anything about it in my notes.
Yeah.
I personally, like, similar to you, I find it kind of uninteresting.
Yeah.
As a piece of symbolism, I find the green light more interesting.
Yeah, more interesting.
Than this. I think that the idea with, like, and I don't even know that it's necessarily, like, God in, like, the American Christian sense
right.
of God.
Yes.
But I think it speaks to... maybe Fitzgerald's kind of disillusionment with the mood of the 1920s.
Yeah.
And kind of, because the 1920s were this kind of like, you know, everybody was struggling to figure out what the meaning was.
Yeah.
And it resulted in this kind of very like loose moraled period of history. So I think, you know, what we're meant to get out of this is maybe this idea that like it actually does matter what you do.
Yeah.
Like what the actions that you take might feel meaningless to you, but somebody sees them and they have an effect on somebody.
Yeah. I just did a quick, went to a quick Spark Notes here, a little
bit. Gotta love Spark Notes.
The eyes of Dr. T.J. Eckelberg. This is from their symbols and themes section. They may represent God staring down upon and judging American society as a moral wasteland.
The novel
never makes this point explicitly. Instead, throughout the novel, Fitzgerald suggests that symbols only have meaning because characters instill them with meaning. The connection between the eyes of Dr. T.J. Eckelberg and God exists only in George Wilson's grief-stricken mind. This lack of concrete significance contributes to the unsettling nature of the image. Thus, the eyes also come to represent the essential meaninglessness of the world and the arbitrariness, of the mental process by which people invest objects with meaning. Nick explores these ideas in Chapter 8 when he imagines Gatsby's final thoughts as a depressed consideration of the emptiness of symbols and dreams. So,
I feel like I hit pretty,
you hit some
I
of those points,
pretty
yeah.
close there.
Yeah, pretty good.
Still got it.
You did pretty good there. Yeah, and that's fair. That totally tracks. The reveal that Daisy was the one driving the car that hit Myrtle, at least according to Jay Gatsby, is that, and I remember that from the book, so I'm pretty sure that like twist of like, oh, actually Daisy was driving.
That is the twist in the book.
And is it implied that that's actually the truth in the book, or is it, because in the movie it's vague enough that you could assume that maybe Gatsby was lying. I mean, we see the events in the movie eventually and see, but again, we're getting that as like a recall from Gatsby's sort of description of the events.
You know, it is kind of vague, and I think it's interesting in that you could definitely read it either way.
Yeah.
Like, yes, she was driving, or no, she wasn't, and he's just making that up.
Yeah.
But I don't think there's any reason to think that he would be lying in that moment.
No, I agree.
Like, just talking to Nick afterwards.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe, because I think you could also make the argument that he's, like, a compulsive liar.
Yeah.
But I don't think there's any, like solid, like, concrete, like, plot reason for him to be lying about
that. No, and I also think thematically it makes the most sense that Daisy is driving, because mm-hmm. it ties in with this idea that this monster he's created has gotten out of control and, like, again, sort of losing the reins on the dream, this Daisy, this sort of idealized creature that he has created in his mind. He sort of loses the reins on it and gets out of his control, literally. Mm-hmm. I think makes more sense thematically that she would be driving than him, and that it turns it even more tragic too, because then Nick is killed Gatsby gets killed because of because of that. But it's actually, but it is his fault. Like, he's the one who drove her to, you know. Like, his actions and his insistence of her validating his ego is what led her to have this breakdown and storm out. But, you know, it's so I think it totally makes it. She was the one driving, if for no other reason than thematically, it makes the most sense. But I did wonder if that was like a confirmed thing or whatever. The last thing Nick says to Gatsby before he has to go to, you know, he's heading out. He says, you're worth the whole damn lot of them put together. And he says a couple other things, but that's like the vague, like, last line. And I had a memory of that being from the book, but
yeah, that is.
Is that like their last conversation?
Yes.
Okay.
And then he says he was glad that he said it.
Yeah. So then at when Gatsby gets murdered at the end, by George, he's getting out of the pool. He's waiting for Daisy to call because he thinks Daisy will call and they'll run away together or whatever. That once she calms down, she'll call the next morning and things will be fine. And as he's getting out of the pool in the movie, the phone starts ringing. And we see we get it cut together in a way where it becomes clear that the person calling in that moment actually is Nick and not Daisy. But Gatsby has this moment of, he doesn't know that. He hears their phone ringing, turns, and the guy, he hears his butler or whatever say, Gatsby will be very happy you called, and he like kind of smiles, and then he gets shot and killed. And I wanted to know if that moment, that like last moment of happiness for Gatsby because he thinks Daisy did call but then it turns out it was actually Nick, that sort of bait and switch, if any of that comes from the book.
Though there's no implication at the end that anyone was calling Gatsby when he was shot.
Okay.
Wilson just shoots him when he's floating in the pool,
right,
and then commits suicide.
Yeah.
I didn't mind this change, though. I thought it was an interesting, like, bait and switch.
Yeah.
I hated it initially because I thought it was going to actually be Daisy.
Yeah.
But then it was Nick, and I was like, oh, okay, I like that.
Yeah. And I just thought it was interesting because it's like gives him false hope or real hope, because actually Gatsby was secretly in love with Nick the whole time and Nick was clearly in love with him. I feel like we'll talk about that more here in just a second, because that was my last question for was that in the book. But I've got one in Lost in Adaptation.
Just show me the way to get out of here and I'll be on my way.
Wow, was it lost?
Yes. Yes, and I want to get unlost as soon as possible.
So my only question here is, does Nick want to be Gatsby or does he want to fuck Gatsby? Because it's one of the two. I get the vibe that Nick is supposed to be. There's multiple lines throughout the course of the movie and several, like, the ways things are shot.
Yes,
and
there are some visual cues.
There's some visual cues and the way looks linger and that sort of thing. There are some definite... there's some definite things that point to the idea that Nick may be gay or, you know, bisexual or whatever, into men, shall we say, and potentially into Gatsby specifically. And I want to know if I'm sure this is a thing that has been, it's funny because it's not something, when we read this in high school, that was not the you know, looking at it through that lens was not something that we even remotely.
Not in 2005 in middle America.
And it's funny because we actually did, I will say, I mean, just to give my high school English teachers a little bit of credit, we covered stories that included gay characters and talked about, mm-hmm. like, that wasn't like a thing that we never did, but in terms of like, interpreting the classics through like a queer lens was like not the direction we were going.
No, I did not encounter the idea of the queer lens until college.
Right.
For sure.
And so and because it's something I read in high school and haven't touched since then, it's not something I've ever revisited. And so watching it this time, it was really interesting to me. It's not a discussion I've really like, you know, mm-hmm. been interested in listening to or hearing anything about. And so in watching the movie this time, it was really interesting to me that it became very like obvious mm-hmm. that was an interpretation that this movie was trying to get across, and whether or not that was an initial interpretation of the novel. So that's kind of why I put this in Lost in Adaptation, to see if that is something you think is comes across in the novel, if not, or if, you know, just want to talk about it. So
such an interesting question. You can definitely apply a queer lens to this book. And many have.
Yeah.
I don't think it's inaccurate to say that Nick as a queer man is one of the most popular readings of this text.
Yeah.
So within the text itself, that reading is usually supported by a couple different things. Nick's preoccupation with Gatsby specifically.
Yeah.
His acute attention to other men. For example, if we think back to the description of Tom.
I thought of that at the time.
Yeah. Much more in depth and like focused on his body than any of the descriptions of women were.
Yeah.
And then there's his only explicit romantic interest being Jordan Baker, who is often described in a way that feels masculine adjacent. She also has an androgynous name.
And she's a sports.
Yes, she's a golfer. An athlete.
Like she's, yeah.
And a queer reading is often further supported by speculation about Fitzgerald himself, as many over the years have speculated that he may have been a closeted gay or bisexual man. And Fitzgerald also shares many other similarities with Nick.
Okay.
But there are multiple ways to interpret this text. You don't have to look at it through a queer lens.
Mm-hmm.
As you can imagine, no one in this 1925 novel explicitly labels themselves as gay or otherwise, so it is open to interpretation. This movie, I'm not sure you could look at through anything other than a queer lens.
It was very apparent to me.
Yes, which is fine. Like I said, that is a popular interpretation, and it's one that I imagine a lot of people were expecting to see in 2013 when they went to the movies.
Yeah.
But I do think, like, it's in the book, but I do think that the movie comes down much more firmly on the side of that interpretation than the actual text of the novel does.
Which is something you can do in the movie with mm-hmm. lots of subtle things that wouldn't be textual, with cameras, you know, lingering on things, specific looks on people's faces that might not be described. You know what I mean? There's lots of things you can add that aren't necessarily sort of counter-textual to the novel, but just add on to it mm-hmm. in a way that doesn't violate anything in the text, but just sort of extrapolates in a way that makes that reading much more apparent.
Yes.
Which, like I said, to me this time seemed very obvious that was the intent that Lerman and the filmmaker, you know, the writers and stuff, everybody involved was kind of going for. But I will say it is interesting that they didn't take it to a point where it, again, they never took it to a level where it felt like it sort of violated it's probably not the right word, but like to where it contradicted anything in the text. We don't obviously atextual moments of them like staring longingly into each other's eyes, or like, you know, there's no moment, or like if we had gotten the hand brush from
the Pride and Prejudice hand brush,
like that moment, we don't get anything that obvious that would have made it. But it's all stuff that feels. So I think it's actually kind of well handled in that regard, where I don't think you could miss I'm sure there were some boomers who missed that in the 2013 movie. But I think it would be hard to miss that reading. Mm-hmm. But it's not, it never, the movie never goes to a place where it feels like it's adding necessarily.
No, I don't think the movie really added. I think the movie emphasized.
Yeah. It focuses on certain things,
yes,
and lingers on certain things.
I actually think like if you've read this book and you just like don't really see the kind of like queer lens, like if you struggle to view the novel through that lens,
yeah,
I think you could watch this movie, yeah, and be like, oh, I get it now.
I get it now, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think for sure it would come across a little bit better. Because again, it, not something that came across to me at all reading it in high school, came across in spades watching this movie. So, all right, now we're going to find out what Katie thought was better in the book.
You like to read?
Oh, yes. I love to read.
What do you like to read?
Everything.
So this is going to be a somewhat short segment. All of my segments are pretty short this time. And that's mainly because this is actually a pretty faithful adaptation.
Yeah.
There are changes, of course. But in terms of like the plot and even a lot of the dialogue, a lot of this film is actually pretty spot on.
Yeah.
But I do have a couple things. First, right off the bat, it's some of the first lines in the movie. It's also some of the first lines in the book, which is Nick recalling the advice from his father. In the movie, it's something generic about like not judging people.
Yeah.
I forgot exactly what it was already because it was so generic. I like forgot it immediately.
Yeah.
But the book's version is whenever you feel like criticizing someone, just remember that all the people in this world haven't had the advantages that you've had, which I feel like
real great advice
is real great advice and also much more thematically relevant,
yeah,
for this book,
yeah,
than some kind of generic like never judge people.
Don't judge people too. Yeah. You know, absolutely. It's one of my sort of moral philosophical,
yeah,
like
and
cornerstones,
it basically
is trying
is
to acknowledge and remember the moral luck and privilege that different people are,
yeah,
and lack of luck and privilege,
yes,
that people are born into.
And I mean, it basically does boil down to don't judge people.
Yes.
But it's a much more specific way of looking at that idea of not passing.
I mean, it's a very progressive. I mean, it's literally just like check your privilege. Just
yeah,
set, it's just check your privilege, written by, yeah, F. Scott Fitzgerald in 19, you know, in the 19 whatever, whenever he wrote the,
yes,
40s or whatever, 30s. When did he write it? I mean, it's set in the 20s.
He wrote it in the 20s.
Oh, I didn't know he wrote it. I thought he wrote it like, you know, in the 30s or something.
No,
but literally, that's just the 1920 version of check your privilege. So it,
yeah,
yeah.
But I do think that, like, to me, this is very, like, followable advice.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, don't judge people is like, okay.
Sure, yeah.
But, you know, this is something that you can actually take and, like, when you feel like you are judging someone,
yeah,
that you're able to, like, step back and be like, okay, that person, I'm judging them, but maybe they didn't have the access to education that I had.
Right.
You know,
yeah,
something like that.
Yeah, the line in the movie is truly terrible in comparison. In my younger and more vulnerable years, my father gave me some advice. Always try to see the best in people, he would say. As a consequence, I'm inclined to reserve all judgments, but even I have a limit.
Yeah, that's so horrible and generic.
Yeah.
I don't know why you wouldn't. Why wouldn't you just keep this line? It's a,
yeah,
great line.
Yeah.
Next thing, at one point, Gatsby in the movie calls Nick. And this shall not be born, because he never calls him Nick in the book.
Does he?
I maybe I missed an instance, but I'm
sport.
Pretty sure he only calls him Old Sport. And it's one of my favorite like interpretations or like little things about the book that people sometimes talk about is the idea that he calls Nick Old Sport because he can't remember his name and he's too embarrassed to ask.
That is a good, that's a fun, yeah, that's a fun little, like, fanon or whatever.
So
yeah,
when he called him Nick in the movie, I was like, no, he is Old Sport.
Old Sport.
So we meet the character of Clip Springer.
Yeah.
In the movie, who in the movie is Gatsby's like live-in organist.
Yeah.
I guess.
A descendant of Mozart, supposedly.
Supposedly. In the book, he's a dude that's basically squatting in Gatsby's mansion, and Gatsby just lets him because he doesn't even care.
Sweet.
Which I think is interesting.
Yeah.
So we mentioned Tom and Daisy's daughter earlier and how we don't really see her in the movie until she appears at the very end. But there is a scene in the book where Gatsby meets their daughter. And he just keeps looking at her like he didn't think she was actually real. And I think it would have been really interesting to see him unnerved by this living representation of Tom and Daisy's relationship.
Yeah, I think that could have been really cool. Really interesting, for sure.
So my last thing here, the movie gives us a, I mean, it's close. Gatsby, after Gatsby dies at the end, Nick is like the only person who comes to the funeral.
Yeah.
But in the book, his dad comes.
Mm.
We meet Gatsby's dad. And I would have really liked to see this because his Nick like manages to get a hold of his family.
Yeah.
And his dad comes to go to the funeral. And he comes in, and one of the first things he says is, "Where have they got Jimmy?"
Mm. Yeah.
Which, that line brings down the entire myth of Jay Gatsby so beautifully and so succinctly. It's chef's kiss from here to eternity, and I'm a little mad that we didn't get that in the movie.
Yep. I can agree with that. But the movie did some things well, so let's go ahead and find out now what Katie thought was better in the movie.
My life has taught me one lesson, Hugo, and not the one I thought it would. Happy endings only happen in the movies.
Oh, we talked about the scene where they, where Nick meets the Wilsons, and then they all go to Tom and Myrtle's affair apartment and they party. I thought that scene was good. Awkward, stressful. The scene where they're like fucking in the other room and Nick is just sitting awkwardly on the couch.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, that's, yep. We've been there. And then like the party, his sister, the other couple, just like loud and trashy and awful. In the book, I didn't get the vibe that it was quite as intense as what the movie shows, but I liked the heightening of that whole situation.
Yeah.
There's a quick line at the first Gatsby party that Nick goes to, said by this guy that Jordan is running around with, who's not in the book. She's just with Nick the entire summer.
Yeah.
But he says, "Poor boys don't marry rich girls." To him. And I liked that this purported moment from Fitzgerald's life got worked into the story because supposedly that's something that the father of that like heiress that he was dating before he met Zelda said to him.
That's right.
Supposedly. I do want to point out, though, that Nick isn't exactly poor.
No.
He's not as rich as Daisy and Tom or Gatsby.
No, they're, yeah.
So, like, comparatively, sure. But his family is funding his life in New York.
Yeah.
And
he lives in the nice.
Yeah, he, like, he I mean, not in a great house in a nice neighborhood, but, like, his family owns a wholesale hardware business.
Yeah.
And they're described in the text as prominent and well-to-do.
Yeah.
Like, they had money.
Yeah.
They just had, like, Midwest money and like, not East Coast money.
Yeah. They were the top 10% instead of the top 1%.
I didn't mind that the movie put more emphasis on Gatsby basically being, like, a gangster, kind of. It's a little more subtle in the book, which I think has its own merits. But I thought the movie added a layer of unease to Gatsby's character that I enjoyed.
Cool.
This is a little thing, but when they're driving, when they have the awkward, horrible lunch and they fight and then they drive to the hotel in the city and fight more.
Yeah.
On the drive there, when they're in the separate cars, Daisy does this like little wave to Tom while she's in the car with Gatsby that just really tickled me. I have this here. I'm not married to having this here. I had this note because I thought for sure that the movie would not do this, but they actually did have Tom drop the K slur.
Yeah.
And now in the book, it's Mrs. McKee, the friend of Myrtle and Catherine, that other couple shows up. Yeah. She uses that word in reference to an ex-boyfriend. A little bit more on that later, so remember that I mentioned that. But I did think it made sense to have Tom say it about Wolfsheim, since we already know that Tom is an awful racist.
Yeah, he just kind of embodies all of the...
Yeah, I mean, I still think we could have just maybe done without the slur altogether.
Yeah.
But I guess moving it makes sense.
Yeah.
I was actually, like, pretty floored that the movie kept that in. I thought for sure they would just drop that word.
Nah, it didn't surprise me.
I actually have a couple little things that I forgot to put in my notes. I liked that the thing that kind of tips off Wilson, there's an item that tips him off that his wife is having an affair in both the book and the movie. And in the book, it's a dog leash because Tom gets her that little dog that we see at the apartment. And in the movie, it's a pearl necklace.
Yeah.
Which I liked because we also know that he gave Daisy a pearl necklace. Mm-hmm. Another thing that I liked was that when we get to see the scene where George is telling her God sees what you do. And then she sees Gatsby's car.
Yeah.
And she knows that earlier Tom was in that car.
Yeah.
And that's why she runs out. I liked giving her that like motivation explicitly because in the book we don't know why she runs out into the street.
Just sort of runs out.
I mean, to get away from George ostensibly.
Yeah.
But I liked giving her that kind of explicit like, oh, there's that car. I can run out and Tom will help me.
Right. Yeah. No, it makes sense for sure.
So in the movie, we see Tom kind of rat out Gatsby to Wilson.
Yeah.
He, like, tells him that's who owns the car.
Yeah, so that's Gatsby's car.
Yeah, it's Gatsby's car. Somebody ought to make that guy pay, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. It's a little on the nose. But in the book, we learn, like, much later that it was, in fact, Tom who told Wilson. Who did that. And I thought it made sense to just move that.
Just have that scene happen.
So we can see it. It makes sense.
Yeah.
It's all very, like, succinct.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yep. Makes perfect sense. All right. Now let's go ahead and see what the movie nailed.
As I expected, practically perfect in every way.
So as I said, this is a fairly faithful adaptation, and those are the kind that I struggle with for the movie Nailed It, because I'm like, should I just put everything in here? No, I don't think that's the answer. And there's also a lot that we've also already previously discussed in our other segments, so I'm just going to run through a few things that really stuck out to me as we watched the movie. Not an exhaustive list. Myrtle, Tom's mistress, calling the house during dinner in that first scene with them. Tom breaking Myrtle's nose at the end of the party. Wolfsheim wears jewelry made out of a human molar.
Yeah.
Weird little moment.
Very strange.
It's cufflinks in the book, so the movie changes that to a tie pin. But he does have human molar jewelry. That's, again, like maybe a historical context thing that I'm not...
Yeah, I don't know.
...read up on. I don't know. At the tea, Nick accuses Gatsby of acting like a little boy and basically shames him into going back in and talking to Daisy. Gatsby's iconic line...
Ah, yes.
...can't repeat the past. Why, of course you can. That's the moment, if somebody ever says that, you know something is wrong. Something is terribly wrong in this situation, and something bad is going to happen.
Yeah.
That's the moment you should know. Daisy's line to Gatsby, you always look so cool. And that's somehow the thing that tips off Tom that they're having an affair. Gatsby's other line, I haven't used that pool once all summer, which is a line that I love because if you haven't read the book, it's foreshadowing.
Yeah.
But if you have read the book, it just becomes dramatic irony.
Yep.
And then this is a line from Nick's voiceover in the movie. They were careless people, Tom and Daisy. They smashed up things and people and then retreated back into their money and their vast carelessness, which is another line that I love. I think it's just a very succinct breakdown of how wealthy people tend to operate.
Yeah.
Destroy everything in their path and then retreat back into their money.
Yeah, I had a note about that and how that's very clearly sort of what the Valley of Ashes sort of represents. It's that the wasteland of filled with like laborers, like, you know, and the working class that separates and allows the
and makes both lifestyles possible.
Yes. And makes their lifestyles possible and how it's that working class that always ends up being the victim. You know, it's Myrtle, who's, you know, the wife of a mechanic, and how it's they're the ones who always end up paying, you know, end up be suffering the fallout of the sort of the mistakes and the and everything and all of the like the line said, just all of the how they smash things and people and retreat back into their money and their vast carelessness. It's again, it's not subtle. The Valley of Ashes and the fact that everybody we see there is like covered in, it's like the it could be on like a USSR poster of like a of like the proletariat hero,
or a production of Oliver Twist.
It's not subtle, but it is really effective, and gets its point across beautifully. And that line is one of those that, again, a little on the nose, kind of just puts it out there, but it's good stuff. All right, we've got a few odds and ends before we get to the final verdict. So the Art Deco, this movie opens, the opening credits, we get these gold lines and it's like, you know, just punching you in the face with the Art Deco. And it's a very obvious choice, but I think it still works.
Yeah, totally.
And it's a very effective look for the film and gets across the opulence and all that sort of stuff while still looking really neat. So that was a smart choice, if not the easy, obvious choice.
The scene where we first meet Daisy and Jordan, really something.
Yeah. Wait, which scene is this?
When he walks into the room and the curtains are all blowing everywhere.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And I stuck that here because I really struggled with where to put it. Because it's not dissimilar to what happens in the book.
Oh, yeah.
I think the movie kind of, for me, took it over the edge in a not so great way when they're like giggling and you can just see like their fingers touching.
Yes, there's very much, the movie again is implying some canoodling there that is never seen necessarily.
We walked through a high hallway into a bright rosy colored space, fragilely bound into the house by French windows at either end. The windows were ajar and gleaming white against the fresh grass outside that seemed to grow a little way into the house. A breeze blew through the room, blew curtains in at one end and out the other like pale flags, twisting them upward toward the frosted wedding cake of the ceiling, and then rippled over the wine-colored rug, making a shadow on it as the wind does on the sea. The only completely stationary object in the room was an enormous couch on which two young women were buoyed up as though upon an anchored balloon. They were both in white, and their dresses were rippling and fluttering as if they had just been blown back in after a short flight around the house.
Yeah.
So, like, visually.
Visually.
We're not far off.
Very, very similar. But there's definitely, with the sound mixing and the close-ups, it's definitely evoking an erotic scene.
Yeah.
But it never you know, there's no payoff. There's no, like, right, confirmation.
That never goes anywhere.
No.
There's no, like, further hint that there's anything between them.
Yeah.
That I picked up on.
I also didn't.
And I usually pick up on that.
Yeah, I felt similarly. That didn't seem, like, beyond that
scene.
Yeah,
it seemed
really went
very, like, male gazey to me.
I mean, I guess, like, I could you could say that it's male gazey in a way that's, like, completely non gazey. Like, there's, you don't, like, see anything.
It's male gazey in, like, an artsy way.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that. Yeah,
because there's no payoff at all.
Yeah,
it's just this one random scene where they're, like, giggling and lacing their fingers together.
Yeah,
it's the suggestion of the male gaze.
It's only the male gaze if it comes from the male gaze region of France. Otherwise, it's just sparkling misogyny. I don't know. Yeah. No, I get what you're saying. 100%. 100%.
It's like if male gaze... It's like if there were a LaCroix flavor.
That's kind
of
what I was going
to male gaze.
LaCroix male gaze.
Yes.
Yeah. That'd be a terrible flavor. They should not.
An awful flavor.
They should not come out with that. It would smell, or it would taste, how a strip club smells.
Oh,
and if you've
God.
Ever been to a strip club, you know how that smells. So, yep. Good Lord, the frenetic pace of the editing during Nick's flashback at the beginning was giving me a headache, like, right away. Luckily, it calmed down.
Mm.
The movie sort of calmed down a bit. But that opening, the speed and manner in which Nick's flashback was edited was like a bad music video. And I was not on board with it. And like I said, luckily it kind of evens out and the rest of the movie didn't keep up that frenetic pace. But I was worried upon that first scene with the flashback to his story. I was like, oh, if the whole movie does this, I'm going to have to tap out. But it didn't.
There were actually a lot of visual choices in this movie that I didn't particularly care for. To me, it often felt kind of similar to Moulin Rouge.
I've seen Moulin Rouge once when I was
we were kind of comparing it to Romeo and Juliet earlier, but I feel like Moulin Rouge is the more apt
comparison. I'm sure it is.
And those similarities to me, I felt like made it feel kind of cheap and done.
Yeah.
Like, we've already seen this.
Yeah.
Pause. Come on. Like, the party scene with Myrtle and Tom and her sister, like, I liked that scene. I enjoyed it. But it also felt kind of reminiscent of the scene in Moulin Rouge where Ewan McGregor's character drinks absinthe for the first time.
Yeah.
Like, and that was something that I noticed throughout.
Yeah.
Like, and there are a lot of similarities between the stories and, like, thematically, and I get that. But, like, I felt like we weren't really treading new territory visually here.
Yeah. And, I mean, I will say, I will defend at least the sense of, like, you know, style... Directors have styles. They have sort of visual shorthands that they tend to use.
Yes.
And so I don't think you necessarily have to innovate a new visual style every time you're making a new movie. If I thought that, I couldn't be the fan of Edgar Wright that I am, because his movies, he innovates a lot from each movie. I mean, and you know, like, Scott Pilgrim looks nothing like some of his other movies and that sort of thing. But a lot, you know, a lot of his movies use a lot of similar visual motifs and things throughout in a way that is definitely repetitive, but it becomes, again, more of a motif as opposed to, like, a worn out sort of done thing.
I guess for me, like, Romeo and Juliet and Moulin Rouge are visually distinctive from each other enough, I feel like.
Yeah.
That the similarities between this and Moulin Rouge became heightened for me.
Okay, that's interesting. It's tough for me because I haven't seen Moulin. If I saw it, I saw it once in, like, middle school or high school or whatever, but I don't remember anything about it, so it's tough for me to kind of compare them.
We're going to watch that sometime. I love that movie.
Okay. I think I've seen it, but I don't remember anything about it. I think it's one I saw in high school and then not since ever again, so...
I really love Rhapsody in Blue, even though it's a super obvious music choice for this movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's a classic for a reason. I love that. It's a standard for a reason.
Yeah.
Speaking of the music, the modern music, I mentioned this earlier, but I get the modern music, but I wish they hadn't. I wish they had done, if anything, was, I think, is just take standards and like remix them. Like they kind of did with Rhapsody in Blue.
Mm-hmm.
Like take period standards, like period hits, and sort of like redo them in an interesting way, I think would have been better. But like, there's a whole scene where I can't even remember what Jay-Z song is, but it's just a Jay-Z song plays for
I get it. I didn't mind it as much as you seemed to. But it's interesting too, because I feel like what you're describing is then the opposite of the music in Moulin Rouge, which is modern music, like kind of restylized to fit more into like the
French.
Which,
that's interesting.
Yeah.
See, that's interesting. I like the idea of that. And I guess what I thought would have been interesting is take period songs and restylize them
modernly. Yeah, that could have been interesting.
As opposed to, because I get why they did it again. It's like the one place where they're kind of one of the places where they're kind of trying to like modernize the story and make it connect with a modern audience is by giving us like these big bombastic pop songs.
Well, and I think too, it might have helped if, and I would have to go back and look at what the soundtrack is even to remember, but like done more commentary with the music, like drawing parallels between like the 1920s and like the kind of like our modern society.
I think they tried to.
Yeah, I think they tried to. I don't know that it quite works out the way they wanted it to.
Because
at least
like
for me.
Yeah, because I was thinking of another show that used modern music, but I thought worked really well, and it was a TV show. I know some people didn't like it, but I liked it. Was
Bridgerton. Yeah.
Which took modern pop songs and recontextualized them, similar to like Moulin Rouge, as you're saying.
I recontextualized them
as like symphony pieces or whatever. Which I thought worked really well and I thought was interesting. And I thought if they'd either done, I guess they didn't want to do that again. Didn't want to take pop songs and retextualize them as like 1920s, like swing, you know, like big band numbers. But I thought that would have worked better. Again, I guess the idea is that I already did that.
Right.
We already did that in Moulin Rouge. But like, I think that would have been better, or take old standards and update them somehow.
Maybe the concern was that like nobody knows enough music from that time period.
I think there's enough, and you could cheat. You don't have to actually do the 20s. You just have to do anything from that era of like anything pre-1950.
Any kind of jazz, big band, blues, that's fair.
Anything like that. It doesn't matter. I mean, because like we talked about with the costuming and the wardrobe, they didn't stick to the specific, you know, year or two that the movie is set. They stretched all the way into like the 30s and stuff. Like, so I think you could do that musically and it wouldn't really matter other than annoy some, you know, music pedants. But
I will say, I think it's too bad that Take Me to Church came out in 2014, because this movie was screaming for that song.
Yeah, for sure. I will say, when we didn't get contextual, or when we didn't get like pop songs, they're specifically the scene where Daisy and Gatsby like have their reunion. It's in the tea scene. But like when he walks in and they see each other and they spend, it sits there forever. And I really thought the score was really perfect for that moment, and the weight of the scene and how long they spend on it. Everything about that felt like appropriately heavy. And I don't know, I thought that moment was like masterfully handled. And I really liked the score in that moment. And again, it's just sort of like actual film score. It's not, it's not like a contemporary song or anything like that. But I really enjoyed that, that moment in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
certainly glad to see you again.
I'm certainly glad to see you as well.
All right, so on a more serious note, I do want to take some time to talk about this novel and race.
Yes.
Now, like I said earlier, I wouldn't say that race is a main focus of this text.
Mm-hmm.
Like, not like classes.
No.
But it does come up.
Yeah.
So first off, let's talk about the character of Wolfsheim.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm saying his name correctly.
Wolfsheim.
Yeah. So this came up in our prequel episode, but the text descriptions of this character have garnered accusations of anti-Semitism.
Yeah.
And now having reread the text, yeah, it's not great. It's not great. He's described as a small, flat-nosed Jew with tiny eyes and two fine growths of hair in his nostrils.
Yep, that's about as stereotypical as you get.
There's a lot of focus on his nose. So yeah, pretty stereotypical. Aside from Wolfsheim, we also have the character that I mentioned earlier who unfavorably compares George Wilson to a man that character describes as the Kaisler. So, even though I knew those descriptions of Wolfsheim were coming, it was kind of jarring to see them in an otherwise kind of progressive text.
I don't know how much of it is intentional, and it seems like a fair amount of it is, but it's very easy to get a fairly progressive reading from the movie, from the book. I'm saying in reference to the movie, I haven't read the book in 20 years or whatever, but I think it's very easy to get a fairly progressive reading out of it. It has a lot to say about class. It has and it has stuff to say about race, and you know, our villains are racist, and like there's some not so subtle progressive elements of the story, and overall it seems to be a very class conscious sort of an analysis and deconstruction of wealth and the sham that is the American dream. So like it, in that regard, it's very quote unquote woke.
As far as those descriptions of Wolfsheim go, I do think it's a symptom of the time period.
Yeah, I mean, you always have to be consider now, that at least.
I don't think that time period should be used to excuse that kind of thing, but I do think it's important to remember that when you're reading an older novel, sort any older source like this, you aren't just reading a work of fiction, you're also reading a historical text.
Yeah.
And used properly, that can open a window to the past as well as start a conversation about how race and popular culture has changed over the past century, how it hasn't changed, and what work we still need to do. Point being, when you're reading an older text, you're basically guaranteed to come across outdated perspectives and language, whether that's in regard to race or myriad other issues.
Absolutely.
And quite frankly, I just think that saying, well, it was just the time period, or saying this is problematic and then never talking about it are equally useless responses.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, I neither of those accomplish anything. So
no, yeah. They both just kind of like, meh, hand wave it away. Yeah.
So to that end, let's discuss how the more current piece of media handled this aspect of the story. So the movie cast Amitabh Bachchan. I looked it up.
Bachchan. I wrote down,
I always write down these mnemonics and then I forget what I meant by the mnemonic. Anyway, so they cast him as Wolfsheim, which is interesting.
Yeah, I was going to mention this,
He's an Indian actor, and as far as I could find, not Jewish at all.
Yeah.
And to me, that feels like an attempt by the movie to sidestep the issue of Wolfsheim being a racial stereotype.
Yeah.
So, like, to my mind, they handled it by not handling it at all, which is not a solution.
Yeah.
And, like, I am glad that we didn't have to hear Tobey Maguire narrate anything about Wolfsheim's nose. But to me, this feels like, one, avoiding the issue rather than addressing it. And, two, reeking of a casting problem that Hollywood is notorious for, which is treating people of color like they're interchangeable.
Yeah. Yeah, and just being like, well, it's different ethnic, different minority group.
Yeah.
Swap them in there.
And, you know, I think that the solution, first off, hire a Jewish actor.
Yeah.
Like, you know, maybe somebody who has experience doing period pieces.
Yeah.
Make sure you have at least one Jewish person on your writing team.
Yeah.
And then I think what they could have done, and I'm just spitballing here, and I'm not a screenwriter, but I think maybe what they could have done was just play the character a little differently. Like, maybe do like a, like, he comes off as like a fatherly type of figure, but then there's like this kind of aura of menace because he's still like a gangster kind of.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think they could have done something more interesting with it to like address that issue, but also, I don't know, just like not avoid it.
Yeah, I definitely think there is a way to handle it that would have been
better,
yeah, for sure. Just kind of ignored it as it was.
So another aspect of this novel that didn't make it in the end of the movie is the potential to read both or either Gatsby or Daisy as multiracial but white passing.
Hmm.
So in my opinion, the actual text of the novel better supports this reading for Daisy. There's an odd moment near the beginning of the novel when Tom is talking about white people being the master race. Civilizations going to pieces, broke out Tom violently. I've gotten to be a terrible pessimist about things. Have you read The Rise of the Colored Empires by this man Goddard? Why, no, I answered, rather surprised by his tone. Well, it's a fine book and everybody ought to read it. The idea is that if we don't look out, the white race will be utterly submerged. It's all scientific stuff. It's been proven.
That all was verbatim.
Yeah, that was all from the movie. And then Tom blah, blah, blah. They have a little conversation. The idea is, this is Tom again. The idea is that we're Nordics. I am, and you are, and you are. And after an infinitesimal. Mm-hmm. After an infinitesimal hesitation, he included Daisy with a slight nod. And she winked at me again. So there's this kind of odd moment where he, like, points to everybody in the room,
yeah,
and identifies them as being, like, of the Nordic race.
Right.
And then hesitates when he gets to Daisy.
Wait, read it one more time.
The idea is that we're Nordics. I am, and you are, and after an hesitation.
An infinitesimal hesitation.
Yeah.
Okay.
He included Daisy with a slight nod.
Interesting. Okay. Huh.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when
he, I wonder if he does that in the movie.
No, I don't think so.
Okay, I didn't. I didn't know to look out for that.
Because I was looking for it, but okay. I don't think they included that. And then,
which would make sense because
in the part that I read earlier, where he's slippery sloping about interracial marriage. Next thing, they'll throw everything overboard and have intermarriage between black and white. Flushed with his impassioned gibberish, he saw himself standing alone on the last barrier of civilization. We're all white here, murmured Jordan. So there are two, like, kind of, to me, odd moments where I feel like you could read into those.
I mean, that first one for sure.
Yeah.
You would almost have to read into that something.
And contrary to your memory, Daisy is also canonically described as having dark hair.
I'm sure I just attached it to the movie.
Yeah. Well, every single film adaptation of this novel has cast her as a blonde woman, but she is, on multiple occasions, her hair is described as dark.
Okay. Yeah, that's interesting. It's interesting. I don't know thematically what Daisy being multiracial would add to the story. I always say would add to the story. I guess thematically what the point, not would add, but what the point Gatsby would be going for with Daisy not being multiracial would be. I've thought about this a little bit more since we recorded the episode, and I think one of these sort of obvious thematic lenses you could use, or one of the obvious sort of thematic through lines you could use if Daisy was biracial in the film would be because she is fetishized so much by both Tom and Gatsby. I think tying that into the fetishization of women of color makes a lot of sense, and also the commodification of women of color's bodies and that sort of thing is a very obvious and could be a very powerful sort of thematic direction to take that read of Daisy's character. And I would be really interested to see that as well.
The next point, Gatsby, I can see.
Yeah.
Like, I can see where it would be going if you want to talk about that. But
both of, like, a reading for each character exists.
Yeah.
And the reading for Daisy exists because of those couple of things that I just listed.
Yeah.
The reading of Gatsby as potentially multiracial is a little more metaphorical, fits a little better thematically. The idea that he could be black, but, like, white passing doesn't have any little breadcrumbs in the text like it does for Daisy, at least not that I picked up on, but it does go hand in hand with the idea of him being a working class person trying to claw his way into upper society.
Yeah.
You could read those things as being like simultaneous alongside each other, or I think you could read the more explicit class struggle as like a metaphor for race. Like a metaphor for a metaphor.
Yeah, I also think there's really interesting implications if you read Gatsby as, which obviously in the movie it's Leonardo DiCaprio, right. So whatever, but
yeah, the movie did not lean into this particular reading either of them, the text.
No. And because, yeah, it's Carey Mulligan as Daisy. It was both about as white as you could get, I think, for both of those people, I think.
Pretty white.
But I do think the reading of Gatsby as multiracial is really interesting, especially with it within the story as it plays out, because I think you would have to tweak a few things if you were to do an adaptation of the novel. I think you might have to tweak a couple things to make it really work. But the idea, you know, like you said, of Gatsby sort of clawing his way into upper society, and how, you know, again, the class struggle being metaphorical for representing the race struggle that people of color in America have dealt with forever and continue to. I think there's an interesting sort of dynamic with Gatsby as multiracial, is that ultimately him then achieving that dream, but then being murdered by another working class white guy upon having achieved those dreams and being turned against. George is turned against Gatsby by Tom, by the old money, by the literal, you know, the wealthy elite 1% white.
Yeah.
Moneyed the bourgeois or whatever. And the idea that it's Tom that turns George against Gatsby,
yeah,
who is also, Gatsby at this point is very wealthy, but, you know, it was working class, came from working class roots, and then it being another working class guy, a white working class guy, I think it speaks very obviously and directly to the class warfare that the upper, like the wealthy elites in the US and around the world stoke within classes is stoking that racial,
yes,
the racial, yes. What is the word, I'm blanking on the racial animus within the middle class, within the lower, anybody that is not part of the bourgeoisie, stoking that racial animus and resentment
And then that being the thing that, you know, it is a white working class guy that murders Gatsby, I think lends itself really directly and interestingly to a retelling of the story mm-hmm. that could do lots of interesting things with that, I feel like.
I totally agree. And it's in the public domain now, so get on it.
Yeah. I think, I think you would have to tweak some things to make it work.
Yeah.
But I do think it's there for the tweaking. And I think that's a really compelling potential, like, story, like a compelling retelling of it. I like that. Anyways, cool. All right. It's time now for Katie's final verdict.
Now, are you ready for your sentence?
Sentence? But there must be a verdict first.
Sentence first. Verdict afterwards.
This is not a difficult decision for me to make, but I do think it's going to be tricky to put into words, so bear with me. I'm picking the book. The reason why is a little difficult for me to put my finger on. Like I said, this is a pretty faithful adaptation. All the plot beats are there, a lot of the novel's lines are included verbatim, and what changes were made are, for the most part, pretty small. And like we've discussed, a lot of them aren't even really changes so much as decisions to play up elements that were more subtle in the book.
Mm-hmm.
For me, The Great Gatsby, the novel, has two main points of value. One is its critique of class in America, which you know I love.
Mm-hmm.
And the other is its portrayal of a time period that Americans have spent the last century mythologizing.
Yeah.
Not that we don't do that to every decade.
Yeah.
But to me, the 20s feel especially gilded by history. And I think that might be because we tend not to cover them in history classes.
Not as much.
We just kind of skip from World War II to, like, the stock market crash.
You mean World War
I? Yeah, World War I to the stock market crash.
Yeah, kind of. So, yeah, for sure.
Pretty much everything that we know about the 20s comes to us via pop culture.
Yeah.
I feel similarly about the 50s.
Yeah.
But that's a whole other thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, I think the movie did an okay job addressing the class critique, but it's so baked into the story that I don't know how you could leave it behind.
It's literally the
story.
You can't
story.
Do it without doing it. Yeah.
But the movie's portrayal of the 20s feels to me like that more mythologized version that I'm used to getting from pop culture. Like, it's not the 1920s. It's 2013 does the 1920s.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't necessarily take issue with that in every piece of media. I mean, I don't take issue with that kind of thing in every piece of media. Like, I love Chicago, the musical, and that's also the modern era does the 1920s.
Right.
But since the time period is so much like its own character in this story, I personally just prefer to get that from a primary source.
Mm-hmm.
The other issue here is that if the movie had to do that, like if it had to do that grand mythologized version, I think it could have done something more with that take on the decade.
Yeah.
I think it could have peeled back the gilding a little more or brought it all down just a little harder. I just don't think that aspect of the story was well handled. And for me, it ended up feeling off. Like the vibes were off. So for those reasons, I'm giving this one to the book.
Fantastic. I do, like, just as you were talking there, just to tack on really quickly, I do think it would have been really interesting to take, because, like, one of the things we see in that nightclub that I talked about is, like, all of the singing girls, they're all black women mm-hmm. of color. And I think, and a lot of the people working and hanging out in the bar are, and I think the movie does the very surface level, Tom is racist, like, overtly, like, super racist, like we are the master race.
He is the racist character.
I think it would have been really interesting to give us that glamorized version where like everybody's just hanging out and partying and like all the black people and white people in the clubs are all hanging out partying together, but then show us that, but then peel that back and maybe mm-hmm. show that it's not quite so simple as just like, because that did feel, and maybe, you know, I'm sure there are plenty of places in New York where people were hanging out in a completely desegregated way and getting along just fine. And I'm not saying that's not the case, but I think there's definitely, even applying, you know, like our Daisy and Gatsby and Nick all like kind of like roll their eyes at Tom's sort of overt racism, but maybe giving us something critiquing them more for like their sort of less overt, obvious racism, like finding a way to work that into the story. Again, sort of peeling back the sheen on the rose-colored glasses that we look at previous time periods through. It would have been interesting to do a little bit more of that, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
So, cool. All right, before we get to tell you what's next, we want to remind you that you can do us a giant favor by heading over to patreon.com/thisfilmislit. Support us there for $2, $5, or $15 a month. Get access to different things at each level. You can also follow us on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We also have a Goodreads. You can follow us on all those platforms and keep track of what we're up to and get posts and teases and all that sort of good stuff. I think that's it. Katie, what's next?
Up next, we are kicking off spooky season
officially,
and we will be talking about a horror classic.
The horror classic, you might argue.
Psycho.
One of the horror classics, for sure. That's all right. Psycho, should be fun. I knew it was based on a book, but I've never read the book. I've seen the movie a couple times, but it's been a long time. I saw it once very young, and then I saw it once again in like college, but it's been since college since I've seen it.
I am actually very excited because not only have I never seen this movie,
really,
I actually know nothing about it except for the shower scene.
That's fantastic.
I don't know.
You will be very surprised.
I don't know what happens after that. I don't know what the plot is. I don't know what the point is. I have no idea.
That's really interesting. I'm really interested to see. Oh gosh, because especially if it's different from the book,
yeah,
that could be wild. That maybe the book goes one direction and then, this should be fun. And by the way, we're doing the 2007 remake starring. No, we're not. What is that? What year? I don't even know what year that was. They did a shot for shot remake with the guy from Old School. What's the? Oh my gosh! What is?
I don't think I even knew they remade it.
Yeah, and it's like one of the most notoriously hated remakes. What is Vince Vaughn?
Oh,
they made Psycho Vince Vaughn.
1998. Well, no wonder I couldn't find it. I was Googling 2007.
He plays Norman Bates, but it's apparently, it's just like, it's Gus Van Sant who directed it, but it's supposedly, and I didn't look to see for sure, but it's essentially like, from what I remember, it's like shot for shot. It's just Psycho, but done today, like done in 1998. It's very strange.
Okay. All righty. Yeah. Well, yeah, we will be talking about, not that one.
No, I'm talking about the original, the 1960 or 67 or whatever year it was.
That's Hitchcock, right?
Yes, it's Hitchcock, yes. Is 67? 60. Oh my gosh, 60. 1960, Hitchcock. There cool. You go. It'd be like our third Hitchcock film.
Yeah.
I think. At least second, if not third.
Yeah, we've done two other Hitchcock films.
Yeah, we did The Birds and
Rear Window.
Rear Window, so there you go. Be a third Hitchcock, and that'll be a lot of fun in 2 weeks' time. But in 1 week's time, you can come back and learn a little bit more about Psycho, as well as some other stuff. Get some feedback on The Great Gatsby, see what everybody else had to say about the film and the book and all that good stuff. Until that time, guys, gals, non-binary pals, everybody else.
Keep reading books.
Keep watching movies.
And keep being awesome.